Hi, everybody. I'm Joe Tabanella. Welcome to NLP Introduction. I'm very happy to be sharing with you what I know about NLP. It's very near and dear to my heart. Let me tell you a little bit about myself, and then we'll get into NLP and what it is, how it can help you, and how life-changing it can be. I work here at the school, HMI. I'm a hypnosis instructor, NLP trainer, and biofeedback instructor as well. And the way I got into it is my life was a mess in my 20s. I really didn't understand how we worked, and I was always asking questions, like, how do we work? Why do some people seem to have, like, things go easily for them? But you can say, well, they work hard, right? They work hard. But I knew people working hard and weren't getting anywhere, and people just seemed lucky. And I was like, what's going on here? Like, why did some people just get relationships like that and other people are struggling? Why people are always lucky, some people lucky, and other people are always struggling? And so I spent my whole life pretty much trying to figure out what it is that makes us work, because I had a miraculous moment that happened at 19 I won't get into now. And I started looking at the nature of how we work, and I kind of eventually figured it out, and I was doing a lot of talking about it, but I never really applied it. And I decided to start applying what I figured out, and it changed my life. My whole life changed in every single way. Everything that I ever wanted to achieve, I've achieved, and I continue to do so. And when I was told that I had like 3 months to live, 6 months to live a couple years back, and they were wrong. and when I realized I was going to live, I said, what do I want to do? I want to teach people what I've done. Like, what I figured out, I want to be able to teach people. So I started looking for interventions that touted the principles that worked. And the things I've learned that worked, that had the principles involved in what I was doing, was hypnosis, what some would call mindfulness or acceptance, and neuro-linguistic programming. And I not only did I realize they were touting the same principles, but some of the techniques that were in hypnosis and neuro-linguistic programming, I was actually doing. And you'll find that the things I'm going to share with you tonight, you actually do when you're successful at something. You just don't know you're doing it. And so we're going to shed light on what makes us work. How are we successful? When are we successful? And how to apply certain principles of successful change to our lives that we do automatically. Everyone does this stuff automatically. We just are unconscious of it. And so some are built with it through the confluence of many different reasons, childhood, parenting, predispositions, and some are just, you know, struggling. And so I decided to do this, and I started working at a rehab. I work at a rehab in Malibu, and in Beverly Hills I work at a dual diagnosis treatment center, IOP, intensive outpatient, and then I have a private practice in Woodland Hills. And so I work nonstop trying to teach people how to remove belief systems and emotional charges that are creating our problems, basically the baggage. And when you understand how you work, which is the first basically step to change, is how you work and what is happening inside, then you can start to understand what to do about it and then apply the practice of what to do about it. And so that's what I'm going to be sharing with you tonight. Now, the certification course I do starting in September is 10 days. So, and that, you know, is just about enough in my mind to get a real good handle of NLP. So I'm going to try to squeeze everything in about 2 hours, 2.5 hours tonight, as much as I can. I'm just going to get rid of the fat and try to get down to the basic principles. And hopefully you can leave tonight with, at the very least, the understanding of how you work, and at the very most, real tools to start practicing today when you leave here. Because some are just very simple principles you can apply. There are tons of different exercises and interventions that we use in NLP and in hypnosis. But if you understand certain principles, you can kind of create your own little interventions on yourself, in a sense. Okay, so how did it start? Well, in the 70s, there was a gentleman by the name of Richard Bandler. He was at Santa Cruz studying. His background was actually in math and science and logic. And he was hanging out with psychiatrists, because he was living at a psychiatrist's home. So he started meeting therapists that were getting amazing results. And he was a very curious guy. And he said to himself, there's got to be a way to, you know, find simple ways to do very complex things. So he found out about a woman named Virginia Satir and started studying what she was doing. And she was doing something different than everybody else at that time was doing. At that time, everyone was, not everyone, but many people were doing psychodynamics, going to the childhood, finding out what makes you tick, what your relationship with your mother was and your father, what drives you. And Virginia Satir was like asking questions and very specific questions about how they do things. And she would take people very literally. So someone would say something, and like people are, you know, people are always yelling at me. And she would say, they're yelling at me, at you right now? People yelling at you? And they would go, no, not now. Oh, when do they yell at you? At work. Everyone yells at you at work? Well, not everyone. Who? These three girls at the other desk. They all yell at you? Well, they don't yell at me. And as she kept asking questions, it turned out like one day, one person yelled at her, and it really triggered her childhood memory of her sister was yelling at her, and she burst out in tears and realized she's been holding that internal experience her whole life, projecting it onto others, and there's just assuming everyone's yelling at her and confirming that. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight. So then he started studying another person by the name of Fritz Perls, and again, everyone was talking about the past, and Fritz Perls was talking about the present. How do you, and how you do the problem, not why are you doing it. That makes sense, right? If you're skiing and you're doing it incorrectly, could you imagine if someone walked up to you and said, why are you doing it like that? I don't know. Rather than how are you doing that, and then how do you do it in a correct way? So he started asking questions like how, and he started dealing with the now, which was also unique. When he asked people about Virginia Satir, people would just say, oh, she's great, she's amazing. And they were, you know, chalking up what she was doing to who she was rather than what she was actually doing. So being a systems guy, he said, maybe there's something she's doing that I can model and repeat. So he started studying her, Fritz Perls, and he got the linguistics professor at the University of Santa Cruz, John Grinder, to get involved in this. And he's showing them what he was learning, showing him what he was learning. He got fascinated, and they started looking into it. And they started looking at certain patterns in people's speech and how the therapists ask questions and how they pose the question and pose the statement. And then Gregory Bateson, who was his neighbor, said, you should study this guy named Milton Erickson. So this guy, he's like a psychiatrist that talks to people, and he puts them in like a trance, and then they leave not even knowing what happened. And then they come back, and they don't even remember going to him sometimes, and their problem is gone. And he would just talk in ambiguity. So Virginia Satir was very specific, who specifically, and he was talking in ambiguity. He'd say things like, that's right. Even the chair knows you're relaxing. We all do that. All of us. It's happening now. Can't you feel it happening now? Not yet. Not everyone's there yet. It's a very general way of communicating. And turns out that when you're ambiguous in your speech, everyone's saying, these people, and you're very ambiguous, it puts the critical faculty and the defense into abeyance, so it allows ideas in. If you get too pointed in your suggestion to somebody, like, you should go, leave that person, or you should, you know, exercise or finish your degree, it actually creates resistance. And so by asking specific questions, they realized that Virginia Satir was uncovering unconscious patterns. And by speaking ambiguity, Milton Erickson was giving new unconscious patterns. Who has children here? So if you have children, you know what I'm talking about. Every frickin' thing is a generalization, am I right? Everyone's like that, all girls are like that. Everyone vapes that, every teacher's like that, every dad's like, right? Kids have a tendency to experience their reality through generalizations. And those generalizations get stuck and it becomes their experience of life for the rest of their lives until they become aware that they're doing it. And so, in studying these people, Robert Diltz came aboard later on, but what they started realizing is that if we can model what these people are doing, maybe we could get results, and they started getting results. Richard Bandler would go on stage to someone who had like a phobia of snakes for 20 years and basically get rid of the phobia for, you know, in 10 minutes when all these doctors were trying to get rid of it for 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. So what did he realize? He realized that if he did the same thing they were doing, he'd get the same results, and he started to. But then he said, let's study successful people and see if they have a pattern. Let's see if successful people are doing something inside their minds that people who are not successful are doing. But that's a generalization. We're all successful at certain things. So he started looking at when we're successful, what are we doing that successful behavior usually does, and what are we doing when we're not successful? And he started studying and interviewing people, and he realized there was a strategy, an unconscious strategy to success. I'm going to be sharing that with you tonight, even though it's not on your books, because I think it's important to walk away with this. And the reason I'm passionate about it is because I did all that. Everything in that list of what makes us successful, I figured out years ago, and everything I put my mind to now eventually shows up. I'm patient, I wait, sometimes it takes a year, sometimes it takes 10 years, I don't care, because I'm using these principles, and you'll find that the principles alone are more important than achieving that outcome. Because you're in a certain state, a certain flow of confidence and excitement, so you don't really care about the result, you care about the journey, and it's enjoyable. So what did he come up with? Well, in the book, How Emotions Are Made, Lisa Feldman Bennett uses this wonderful philosophical question to illustrate a point, which speaks to NLP. She says, if a tree falls in a forest and it doesn't make a sound, right? No one's there to hear it, does it make a sound? If no one's there to hear a tree falling in a forest, and no one's there to hear it, does it make a sound? And we used to argue about that, right, in a philosophical question. We know the answer to that question now. No, it doesn't make a sound. It makes a pressure wave. That's all it does. We need three things to make a sound. We need the eardrum, that is a transducer like a radio that takes one form of energy and turns it into another form of energy, from a pressure wave to electrical energy, right? We need a brain to process that signal, and then we need the concept of tree and falling. So if you had the brain and the ear, but you'd never heard of a tree or saw a tree ever, and you never heard of a tree falling or even knew what falling was, all you would hear is Now, if you grew up with aliens all your life on another planet or another city even or another country, and you always were reading about aliens, you heard about aliens were abducting people, you never heard about a tree, you never heard about falling, and you heard, what would your brain go to right away? We're being abducted. Because it has to filter the information coming in through the internal concepts that we already have agreed to exist. So we're creating our realities in that way. No one's creating a reality based on the electrons in front of us. I'm not responsible for someone coming up and punching me in my face. But I'm responsible for everything I think about it, everything I feel about it, all the meanings I give it, the way I think about it after the fact, the way I even thought about it before the fact. And that part of creation, most of us are not actually involved in. We're too busy complaining about the external world we can do nothing about, rather than dealing with the internal world that's creating all these experiences. And they are creating all the experiences. I'm one of those guys that I don't like to talk about anything unless I live it and breathe it and own it. And I can tell you now after 9,000 sessions, and I'm sure every other instructor here would tell you, that this is real. We are creating our experiences. We literally are creating our experiences. And I'm going to show you how. You ready? Okay. So we have all this light and sound. And again, I'm going to just simplify it because we're going to squeeze all this information into a couple hours, right? We have this light and sound hitting our eyes and ears, right? Sensory somatic experiences, right? We have this data coming in, and it's raw data. I'm not seeing you. I'm seeing light waves. So if I'm not seeing you, I'm seeing light waves. So where's the image live? Oh, it lives in my head. But my brain is experiencing light waves. It's an organ. And it has electrical activity and neurobiology. Where are the pictures in there? Where do pictures live? They don't live in the world. They don't live in physical reality. They live in mind. They're the language of the mind. Because I'm seeing light waves, I'm not seeing people. Even when I'm a baby, I don't even see the separation. I don't even see the colors yet. It's just fragmented data, like in an EEG or EKG machine. It's just fragmented data, then it starts to filter it into some kind of pattern that we can understand. But when it first goes in, it's raw data. Well, that's what's happening right now. That's what's happening right now. Data is coming into my eyes and ears, and it's hitting my brain that had memory patterns of data, but the brain just had electrical data and neurobiology. So where are the pictures? It's our mind is where we create pictures, not the brain and not the world. So somehow the neurology speaks to us through our pictures. So when we say neuro-linguistic programming, what that means is neuro, your neurology, what you're seeing, what you're hearing, what you're sensing, right, has a language to it that communicates to us. So we could understand the neurology. I don't speak zeros and ones in my brain, do I? And frequencies. I don't know how to read frequencies in neurobiology. I don't know how to make it an experience out of that any more than I know how to read a computer chip. Anybody know how to read a computer chip? But yet, the computer chip's communicating to us all the time. What's in the computer chips? Zeros and ones, electromagnetic energy patterns. What's in our brains? Patterns, same thing. How do we communicate with the computer? We need pictures and sounds in a monitor. But we're not even seeing the pictures. Even those are dots and zeros and ones. So somehow images live somewhere. Call it consciousness, call it mind. That has nothing to do with reality. Reality is just communicating the best it can by sending up signals and communicating to us. So it's just like a chip shows us a picture on the screen. Our brain creates a picture in the mind, but it's data. So what they realized is that this information is going in, and the brain is trying to make sense of all the data. So it has to do something with this data. What it does with the data is create an internal representation of reality called the IR. This internal representation is really our experience of reality, not the data coming at us. Now, what does this mean? Well, when all this data is coming in, our brain has to do three things. It has to delete, distort, and generalize. So this is how the brain works. It filters reality through deleting, distorting, and generalizing. This is how this works. So let's look at deleting. Right? It's been said that if you were taking in all the information and you were trying to be aware of all the data coming at you, you'd go mad. Depending on what neurologist you speak to, 50 million bits of information a second your subconscious mind is processing. If you try to process 50 million, we can only process about 50 bits of information a second, which comes out to about 7 plus or minus 2 units of information. That's why license plates are about 7 digits, phone numbers. Try going over 9 or 10 when you go to a grocery store. Your brain just can't handle it anymore. The short-term memory can't handle it. So you need some kind of tool or trick to play to remember more than 7 or 8 objects. So when we read, we have to delete reality in order to read. We can't be listening to the birds. We can't be thinking about it. We have to get absorbed in the book. Now, some people do that really well, right? They can delete everything, so almost too well, where the house can be on fire and they're reading a book. And some people don't delete enough. They can't sit still for a second and read a book because they're always being disturbed by this or that person. So, but the deletion process is how the brain helps us to decide what's important. So right now, for example, I'm deleting tons of you. Tons of you. All my brain is doing is looking for my internal representation. So if I was a big military family, guess who I wouldn't be deleting? Right? Camouflage shirt. That would be important to me. If I like nice outfit, if I was aesthetic, you know, if I was fashionable, I'd be like, oh, cool hat. I wouldn't be deleting these people here. Right? And so we're constantly, the brain is constantly getting rid of everything that's unimportant. It doesn't even see it, like reading a book and not seeing the flies. And it's doing this 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, based on our internal representation. So that's a process that the brain does to keep us sane, by deleting what's unimportant. Are you with me so far?
Yeah.
The second thing it does is it generalizes. It loves generalizing. Why? Because it's easy to learn when you generalize. You don't have to relearn something over and over again. For example, if we were in a tribe and I ate fruit and I went, fruit, fruit, fruit. You know you can eat it and plant it. You don't have to go, what is that thing again? Well, let me tell you, remember that thing I showed you last time? You can eat this too. I just know fruit, eat and plant. If I'm going through the forest and someone with a tribesman with a headdress and a certain tattoo throws a spear at me, I say headdress, tattoo, bad. So I don't make that mistake again. So it's a very helpful tool. But can you see how it's also the reason for most of our problems? Xenophobia, sexism, racism, homophobia, because we have an experience through a filter and then we just generalize every, like the child does. Everyone's like that. And then we delete it when they're not. We literally, the brain will literally delete the experience when it's not there. When it's there, I should say, right in front of our face. We know this because someone could be saying, I love you, I'm here for you, I don't trust you. You're deleting all the love. But I've been there, I remembered every birthday, every Christmas. No, you don't love me. We just delete that. What we're looking for is what we're not deleting, which is our generalization that I can't trust anybody. So that's our generalization. So that's my internal representation. I delete when it doesn't support my generalizations. Does that make sense so far? And here's the coolest thing. We distort. Everyone, imagine you're looking down at your book and you're seeing the word running. You're seeing the word running. And let's say it's on your book. When you see the word running, you know what happened just now? Even just me saying that and you're imagining it? Your motor neurons were starting to fire as if you're about to run. Your sensory neurons were kicking in, trying to smell, taste, touch, or feel what it felt like last time you ran. And all you did is put your eyes on dots on a paper. Think about this. Think about this. You looked at dots, but even that's a mistake. You didn't see dots. Light hit dots, bounce off the dots, hit your eye, that light became an image in your head, a physiological experience, even started motivating you. Talk about distortion. We're distorting experiences all the time. So, for example, you with the Puma shirt, could you just stay just like that? Don't with the same face. Now, hold on. Everybody stop. Now, if I had an internal representation that when I'm up on stage, because when I was 8, it got stuck, people didn't like me and they didn't want me being there. And my internal representation is people don't like me. It's an internal representation of people don't like me. And I would be deleting anyone taking notes. And I'd be seeing, what's your name?
Lucy.
Yeah, well, now I'm actually right about my, you're like, Lucy? So, but look at Lucy's face. And look at the way she's just like that. Couldn't I distort that? Now, it could be true. Sometimes distortions are real. But 95% of the time, it's not. So I can easily distort that look into the Lucy hates me. But meanwhile, she's just, you know, comfortable, kind of looking, maybe thinking about her life. And I distort that into my internal representation. And my brain said, I was right. Who looks at you like this? Now, I know better now. But if I was just my first time up on stage, and I had that internal representation, I'd be generalizing that, looking for that, deleting this, that look. I'd be deleting that. That's not important to me. I'd be distorting it when it's not there and generalizing when I have proof and someone gets up and say, you suck, and leaves. And I go, you see, I'm telling you, this is how people feel about me. But you forgot that person and this person and that person. Yeah. We just delete it. And this filtering system is what the brain is looking for right here. Now, here's the problem with this. And here's the solution. This internal representation tells us which state to be in. And the state drives our behavior, and our behavior creates our results. Do you see why self-help is so difficult? Because where do we normally focus? On our results. I can't believe I didn't lose that weight. I can't believe I have this no relationship. I can't believe I don't have the money. I can't believe I didn't show up for that, you know, that promotion. I can't believe. Why do we have these results? What creates results? Behaviors, habits, physical behaviors create results. Well, what's driving the behaviors? What's driving those behaviors? State. State is driving the behavior. So if I'm in a happy state, I'm happy to show up and create behavior to do something. If I'm in a fearful state, I may avoid and therefore get the results that come with avoiding things. Or if I'm in a fearful state, I may get angry as a defense and then attack people. So an example with Lucy, and you okay what we're playing with this area? So the case with Lucy, I may just have this whole experience in my head if that's how I coped with that state. And all of a sudden I go, some of us with Puma shirts think they know everything. Now she does hate me, and then when she hates me, I go, I was right. Meanwhile, she didn't before. But I was projecting onto her, and I made sure it happened. I remember doing a group once at the place I work, and there was a guy in the corner, and he looked like he was having a bad day. So in a way to respect him, to love him, to take care of him, I ignored him. Like I felt like he didn't want to share or be part of the group. So I just kept ignoring him. He gets up, starts breaking things. I found out later that he was saying, he hates me, ignored me, treated me like shit. I'm like, oh my God, I was respecting him. Because I was ignoring him, that was triggering his internal representation and belief and generalization that no one cares about me. And meanwhile, I was going on my way to care about him. Now, if I didn't know what I knew and didn't know about countertransference, I would go after him, and he would be right, and I'd be right. I would say, what are you talking about? I was trying to take it. You're an idiot. You just got problems. No, you got problems. That would have been a nightmare, and we'd have both been right eventually, because the internal representation will always win. It will always win unless we know it's happening and we change it. So, this is not a relationship class, but I'm going to show you how this works within relationships. Can I? You're going to have fun with this one. Mm-hmm. You ready? Okay. So, if I have the internal representation as a child of mom pulling away and not wanting to be with me, that creates anxiety, right? That creates behavior of what? Neediness, right? Maybe even anger. Maybe passive-aggressive behavior, right? So I'll use me. Let's say I have that internal representation, and I see a woman who's very quiet, very professional, very independent. She triggers my mom, right? Because my mom was cold and distant and wasn't all on top of me, so I wanted her to give me attention. So I might have a belief system here that I'm no good, I'm invisible, I don't matter, I'm not important, yes? So now I'm deleting the women who are there going, I love you. I just want to, you know, I want to hang out. I'm like, get away from me. There's no chemistry there. I want somebody who is going to be, who's going to remind me of my mom so I can quell my anxiety. Because if I'm good enough, whatever I learn, mom will no longer be cold. So what do I have to be? Do I have to be good looking? Do I have to make money? Do I need to be charming? Do I need to be funny? Do I need to give presents? Do I need to leave them alone? What do I need to do to get this cold woman to go like this? So all of a sudden, I'm flooded with what? Dopamine, excitement. I call it chemistry. Yeah, you bet your, you know what? It's chemistry. It's called dopamine. Excitement. You're going to quell my pain. You're going to kill that interim representation, because I don't want to kill it. I don't want to get rid of it. You're going to kill it. But what I don't know is she has her own internal representation. Her internal representation is dad going, who can I, use you, Puma, since we started? I'm going to use Lucy for this one. Okay, internal representation. So Lucy's internal representation is dad doing this. Where are you going? What are you doing? Where are you going out? What are you wearing that for? Why are you doing that? Why are you wearing makeup? You're only 16. Why are you wearing those shoes? Why are your shoes? So her internal representation is, I don't have a right to be, and people are always going to be mad at me. Got it? So that's her internal representation. So she sees me. Lucy sees me. Again, thank you for playing along. Lucy sees me, and I'm going to love Lucy unconditionally because I don't own her. She's not creating anxiety in me yet. I'm just going to shower her with love. And she's like, wow, this is great. Someone adores me and lets me be. You going out? Go out. Lucy, go out. Go out with your friends. Like, oh my God, I'm in love. Someone loves me and lets me go out. Oh my God, go. Whatever you want. You going to Bali? Go to Bali. Have fun. I can't wait to see you. I'm in love with you. Oh my God, someone loves me unconditionally. But the subconscious mind and internal representations are like Glenn Close in Fatal Attraction. It won't be ignored. It won't be ignored. This stuff will not be ignored. It has to come out. So, me and Lucy now move in, honeymoon stage. Having dinner. She's going out tonight. You going out? Go out. Going out with your friend? Oh, you going out with her? Ooh. That's okay. She just seems like she just loves guys, and it's okay. That's fine. Go out, have fun. I love you. I trust you. Bye. Love ya. What time are you coming home? 10. See you at 10. Can't wait. Have fun. 10 o'clock. 10:05. Hi, sweetheart. Hope you're having fun. She said you'd be home at 10. I can't wait to see you. Let me know what's going on. 10:20. Hope you're having fun. You must be having a great time. Great. Just let me know you're okay. Just let me know you're coming home. Just let me know when. That's fine. 10:30. I guess you're having fun! Exclamation point. Because what is that triggering me? My anxiety, mom's going to leave. Now I have internal representations of her gone, and they get good. She's at an orgy. She just met some guy, moved to Brazil with him. She just hooked up with her ex-boyfriend. And I'm already starting to feel it, right? And I text her again. I guess you're having, just, all right, now I'm serious. I'm concerned. Just let me know you're okay. 11 o'clock. Have a great night. I'm going to sleep, exclamation point. 11:15. Have a great life, 30 exclamation points. Because I feel that's the only way that someone is ever going to love me, because whenever mom came back to dad, it was because she was in trouble or he was angry or cold. Then she would be like, what, what? So that's the only way I knew. So she comes, she's just having a great time. She looks at her phone, she realizes how late it is, and sees, oh, he's missing me. Oh, I gotta go, because I just triggered dad. So this unconditional adoration is now, you're done. It's like emotional blackmail, right? This unconditional admiration is gone. He's mad at me. All this great love is going to be taken away. I must have done something bad. So now she has to lie because she feels bad, because she's holding unconditional intern representation of guilt, and I'm holding intern representation of hurt. Mine's turning into anger. Hers is turning into defense or avoidance. And she proves it when she walks into the room. Hey, honey. And I'm like this. Oh, hi, Jeff Fun. Now I'm cold and I'm triggering her need to make me happy. And now the honeymoon period is gone. Lucy starts going, God, my relationship feels restrictive. He's restricting. I always feel trapped and guilty. And then Lucy goes to work and meets Bob. Hey, how you doing? Hey, you still got that guy? Oh boy, he's possessive. Oh man, I'd take care of you. I'd let you do whatever you want. Very attractive woman. Hey, whatever you want. I don't tell, I kiss and tell. I don't tell, I don't kiss and tell. I just want to say, whatever you want, whatever's happening. Listen, I'm having a party tonight. Don't you want to stop by? So now Lucy's going, that's what I'm missing. That someone likes me who's not mad at me. So what do I do? The more anxious I get, the more I come at Lucy, the more that triggers one, her anxiety to run. And this is cross-gender. You can have a male having that energy or a female. It doesn't really matter. It used to be more females had that energy because of the way things were structured in the 60s and 70s. But these days, it's like 50-50 almost, because women are more independent, so their moms are more busy or cold or working on their careers, so might trigger that anxiety in guys, right? So now we have a trauma bond rather than love. So my unconscious is always worried about Lucy, and Lucy's always worried about being trapped or being in trouble. So she's always avoiding me, and I'm always kind of catch her. Why? To prove I was right. And then she finally cheats on me. I said, I was right. Good thing. I told you I was right. You can't trust anyone. They all leave. And one can say, well, she would have left anyway. Yeah, it might have actually triggered her to leave, or it might have attracted a woman who has a fear of intimacy, who's going to leave anyway, just to prove my point. Because I deleted the woman who wouldn't leave. Deleted that. And that's how we create our experiences. Does that make sense? So, the problem here is we're all walking around like this, confirming our experiences. We do it with money. We do it with relationships. We do it with health. We do it with everything. We are actually, and none of us know what's going on in here. You know where all our attention is? It's here and here pretty much. And then we're looking for coping mechanisms. No one stops and goes, what am I actually seeing? Because you'll realize that just about all of our problems are hallucinations that are not happening right here. They're happening in our internal representation of right here, of yesterday's right here, and maybe tomorrow's right here. And it keeps repeating the internal representation of reality. So what do we do about it? First thing is to respect this and realize how real this is. Now, let me give you an example how profound this is. I forget, I may be wrong on the specifics of the study, but I'm generalizing to make the point. So they took a video of a person protesting. Just a video, no context, just a person protesting. That's the only context. And they showed this video to like staunch conservatives, and they said, this person is protesting for, let's just say, gays in the military, right? Does this person look violent or peaceful?
Oh, very, very violent. That's violent. Look violent.
Then they showed the same exact video to a bunch of liberals, and they said the same thing. This person's protesting for gay rights, gays in the military. Does this person look peaceful or dangerous? Oh, very peaceful. Then they took the same video and went to another group of conservatives and said, this person is protesting for pro-life. Do they look, same exact video, peaceful or dangerous, or not dangerous, violent? Oh, they're very violent, very violent. I mean, very, very peaceful, very peaceful. And then they went to the liberals and said, this person's protesting pro-life. Or that. Oh, look, very violent. Same exact stimulus created internal representations for everybody. And then we wonder why the political environment is the way it is. that no one's seeing the other person's internal representation. We're assuming they have our internal representation, so you must be a horrible person. But they're not seeing what we're seeing. And if we were seeing what they were seeing and deleting everything else, we would have the same internal representation. And we would be in agreement with them. But we don't know this is happening. We're not aware that they have a structure, someone else has a structure of whatever the subject matter is that is so written in stone in their brain that anything that's in conflict with that is distorted. There's terms for this, you know, cognitive dissonance, where you're met with opposite proof and you feel like a discomfort in the body because you can't accept that the data you're getting is in conflict with, and then you actually push back even more. There's confirmation bias, where you only just focus on what's important to you, like I was saying before. And so this is what's happening all the time. So what also creates state, and it's a symbiotic relationship, is physiology. Physiology is will add to your state. For example, if I have low blood sugar, I'm going to be in a weird mood, and it's going to kind of throw off my state of being, right? If my posture is like this, it may throw off my state. So if you combine your physiology and your state with your internal representation, you start to form this sense of what they call an NLP, the sense of excellence, a state of psychology and physiology of excellence, which means that you approach anything from this state of being. And this is what they found. And you'll see, you'll agree with me, I think, unless you have an internal representation that's in conflict with it, which is we keep thinking situations are going to make us happy or change things or get things, right? We think like this will happen and I'll be okay. That person will show up, I'll be right. That money will show up, right? But really what we really want is the right state of being. Wouldn't you agree that if you're in the right state, you could do anything? There are Buddhist monks that can be in the right state, go into a coffin underground with just a straw, some not even a straw. They can slow down their metabolism. But some could be on the ground and not be panicked, and someone else could be in a big mansion and be panicked. So who cares if you're in a mansion or you have guard dogs if you're filled with fear, when you can be in a coffin underground and be filled with peace? If you know where you're headed in life, even if it takes 20 years, if you know for sure you're going to get there, you're going to feel good. Wouldn't you rather feel good on the way to getting there than be terrified and then get there? But we haven't. We've been switched. Someone, somewhere, the man, did a little switcheroony on us. And they said, no, you don't have a right to have the state you want. This will give you the state. This will give you the right state. This will give you that thing you're looking for. Ooh, this will take away that other state. Oh, this will give you that state. And it's all up to us. And basically, NLP is about changing states by changing the internal representation, changing it, and accessing positive states just by pure will to remember a time in your life when you felt confident and start to take those states into situations. Because if I, over here, was in a state of confidence and I had an internal representation of what I actually wanted rather than what my brain ever processed, and that internal representation is always this, what would my state be? Go have fun. And if she didn't call me back, concerned, but for her, because I'm concerned, and I would drive around, maybe, if it's really that late, and I would find the restaurant she was at, and I'd go, hey, honey, are you? And she'd be talking to someone, maybe. And I'd go, Lucy, what happened? Oh, sorry, hey, how you doing? I don't need anything from Lucy, I already have the right state. I wanna see if Lucy's gonna continue to match this state, because my state has its own images, doesn't it? And if Lucy's doing that to someone else, that's fine, but it doesn't match me anymore. But I'm curious, because I'm still in the state, so I'm curious. And then rather than attack and trigger Lucy, I can go, hey, what, you okay? No, I don't wanna, no, you don't have to stop talking. Are you okay? Because I was worried. Oh, good, you said 10. Oh, you thought 11. Oh, good, go, I'll see you later. Just come on when you're ready. I love you, I can't wait to see you again. Now, does Lucy wanna come back to me or wanna hang out with somebody else now? Who does Lucy wanna be with? This guy, who's like, go, I love you. Because now I may trigger a little Lucy's anxiety, like, wow, he's so confident. What's he got up his sleeve? Right? Because that will keep Lucy, and that's if she was that character in this situation, if she had an internal representation. And conversely, if Lucy had an internal representation of go, go, you're free, you have a right to be, and she was feeling this state, and I was doing this, where were you? Lucy can easily go, what's going on? Why are you talking to me like that? I love you. What are you doing? Don't do that. Are you insecure? Oh, I love it. Turns me on. But don't talk to me like that. Don't ever do that again. But you're safe. No, we're good. We're good. We're good. I forgot my phone. Stop it. Come here. Come here. Come here. And then this guy would go, oh my God, how wonderful. It never occurs to us, does it? Because what's running our behavior is our state. What's running our state? That internal representation. Now, here's the good news and here's the bad news. Not the bad news. Here's the good news. This is real. It's as real as a heart attack. You really can change everything inside your internal representation. Here's the bad news. You don't do it once and go, hey, it didn't work. You do it until your brain gets the message you're in charge of the data. It's not in charge of you. The servant, unfortunately, has become the master. You're the master, and the brain's the servant. If you're thinking thoughts and images that you shouldn't be thinking that are not resourceful, it's up to you to change them, not for you to acquiesce to your brain's belief of reality. It's for you to go in and change it. So I'm going to give you a little exercise. You ready? Based on that principle. Okay. So everyone, think about someone who really annoys you lately. Who annoys you? Someone triggers you. Someone, come on, it's easy to find. You can't ask people like, you know, something that's happy. They're like, I can't think of anyone. Someone annoys me. Oh, I got one yesterday. Person at work, the person driving, the person checking me in, fact that we waited 10 minutes to shoot, 20 minutes. There's got to be something. So think about someone or something that triggers you. Got it? Okay, so first I'm going to ask you all, did you see an image? You have an image, right? But you didn't have an image. You're looking at your neurobiology. What are you feeling? Emotions, right? No, you're not. You're feeling an autonomic nervous system and hormonal system just moving around in your body, and you call it an emotion, right? And we call that person this pattern of energy. Think about it. You're calling a pattern of energy out there this pattern of energy inside, and you're giving it a picture because that's how the neurology speaks to us, through pictures. So I want to show you what happens. Ready? Really bring them up. You all have one? Good. Really bring it up. Now make the picture a little bigger and a little louder. Make the face a little bit more annoying. Make the tonality a little more harsh. You're going to wear that. You're going to do it that way. Really bring it up. Now you just made it bigger, didn't you? And a little louder. So if you made it louder and bigger, you can make it softer and smaller. So I want you to make it just a little bit smaller. And now imagine you're stepping out of your body, watching your body dealing with this pattern. And see it as nothing more than an internal pattern, nothing to do with you, it's just an internal pattern. Now, what I'd like you to do is drain the color out of this pattern, like a valve. You're just draining the color out of it. Now, imagine you're draining the energy out of it. So it's like a hologram. Now, turn another valve and unscrew the valve. Oh, it's starting to shrink too much. Try to squeeze the valve shut again. It broke. Uh-oh, it's shrinking, it's shrinking, it's shrinking, it's shrinking, it's shrinking. Oh, no, it's shrinking. Try to bring it back up. Oh, it's shrinking, it's shrinking. It's the size of ants. Oh. Now step over that person. You don't want to step on them. And now go along your happy way. And just notice how your physiology just changed. How your state just changed. Because you actually were directly dealing with your own neurology by directly dealing with the language. So neurology, linguistic language of the neurology, which is images, sounds, self-talk, feelings that we call kinesthetic experiences. Right? smells and tastes, you just change the quality of the image, so you're changing the quality of the sensations in your body, changing the state. Just like when you take a computer and you take the mail and you move the mail to the junk mail, you're literally changing the wiring of the chip. So you're literally changing the wiring of your body. Who has an ex that you're trying to get over, that you're really over and you're trying to get over? No one? No one wants to get up on camera. All right. So here's an example of this. Do you realize that everything in your subconscious mind is coded in a certain way, what we call the submodalities of that internal representation? So what that basically means is every internal representation has coding that tells us how to feel about it. Do you ever notice if you're watching a movie in a big screen 3D, it's much more effective and it affects you much more than if you watch it 5 months later on a little black and white screen? Because how we see images, where they're coded, tells us how to feel about them. So the mind works the same way. If you are, like for example, if you're dealing with someone you just broke up with, and you're trying to get over, and you know it's over, you're sure it's over, you just can't get them out of your mind, do you realize that you have neurology called exes? Where at one point you were crazy in love with them, couldn't get over them, and now you think about them, you laugh. If they Facebook you, you delete them. How is that possible? Because the neurology over time did something with it. And so how do you find that neurology? You find, where do exes live, for example? Exes live, when I think about people I was crazy about no longer, they kind of live over here. Where's your present ex live? Right here. So if you change the submodalities, the coding to match this, you shrunk it. You brought it over here, and you locked it in here, your body would go, ah. And you could not have that desire because the brain knows this is dopamine coding and a wanting and a craving, and this is I'm over it coding. So when you make things just small in general and you step out of them and make them small in general, and you continue to do that, certain things will change their coding. I mean, you'll change the coding, therefore changing how you feel about it. One of my favorite students in the NLP class, she used to say to me, what about money always going out? Money going out. It's going out. I said, what are you talking about? Money, it's always going out. I said, I'm confused. That's not an internal representation, that's real. This is how much the brain fools us. I go, money's always going out? Always? Yeah, always going out. I said, are you in a trust fund or something? She goes, no. I said, are you homeless? She goes, no. I said, how do you pay your bills? Well, I work. So she completely deleted that money's coming in. Completely deleted that money's coming in and distorts everything into money going out. So if that's the internal representation, guess what's going to happen? As soon as she starts saving money, the brain's gonna say, we gotta support this. Let's buy those shoes that are $800 because they're on sale. So let's get them. They're normally $2,000, so it's gotta be worth doing it. That's not a sexist comment. That's her liking shoes. So that's how we work. We do with everything. We do it with food. I just lost 10 pounds doing this because I like to be congruent. I said, I want to lose 10 pounds. I've been trying to lose it. You know, you're trying to lose weight for 2 years, 4 years. And I've been at the same weight for 4 years, trying. I said, what am I trying for? I'm not doing the very thing I teach. And in 10 days, I lost 10 pounds, roughly 10 pounds I pound. All I had to do is change my internal representation. The first thing I had to do is have an internal representation of what I wanted rather than the internal representation that I don't like. So I said, I want that Brad Pitt body. Because in my 20s, I had that body, and I don't have it anymore. I said, well, in that movie that he's in, well, every movie, he's got Brad Pitt. He's got that. I said, I want that body. I said, what's that weight? What's my fighting weight? Okay, a certain weight. And I saw the weight. And that was a little bit far away, so I had a little mini goal, which I'm going to be talking to you a little bit later about goals. So I had a little mini goal, but the important thing was I didn't have an internal representation of the desired body I wanted. I knew it. I had an idea, but my internal experience is what I didn't like rather than what I loved. And so I put an internal representation of the body I wanted, and I'm not that vain anymore. I'm in my 50s. It's not like a big deal to have that kind of body anymore. So I'm like, what would motivate me? I needed motivation, and only fire or desire usually motivates us. If there's a problem, like I have to take off my shirt on camera, then all of a sudden I'm in the gym losing weight. Or if I'm in love with this person and I hear that she loves hot bodies, maybe I'll do that. But I'm not, just the vanity of losing weight, I'm in my 50s. I don't care as much as I did in my 20s. So I had no motivation. So I had to use my highest value, which is congruency. This is my work. I take people's money. I better do it just for that sake. So that was strong enough to get an internal representation. I used all my five senses, fell in love with the internal representation, liked it, and then said, how am I going to do this? Well, it's usually two different ways. You drop carbs completely, or you fast, eat much less food. So I decided I was going to fast. I decided I was going to have breakfast, and I decided I was going to have lunch, and then not eat dinner. But I love snacking, watching TV, all that stuff. I don't love it. My brain loves it. I love snacking, eating, you know, looking through the kitchen, finding out something, get cozy, watching a movie and eating something. So I knew that was going to be a problem. But when I looked at it, the state of suffering and craving was really being motivated by internal representation that we will never eat again, ever, ever. And this feeling, the internal representation of the feeling was, you can never have fun, you're going to die. That was the internal experience. So all I had to do is put my hand on my heart, breathe slowly, and tell this body positive self-talk rather than we're suffering. Oh my God, how are we going to do this? This is crazy. Well, let's just eat once. We'll do it tomorrow. I just put my hand on my heart and said, if we don't do it now, we'll never do it. And this is important. So don't worry. We're going to have the greatest breakfast. And guess what? We get to eat anything you want for lunch. Name it. Go ahead, name it. A good pizza? Yeah. But you don't really want pizza. No pizza? No, because pizza is going to take us away from the goal, but we can eat good foods that are also tasty. Blueberries? Yeah, you can have all the blueberries you want. Okay. And I kept breathing, and I started visualizing eating tomorrow rather than never eating again. My body relaxed. It took 2 days, and now I do it like this. I mean it. I do it like this. I mean, I haven't eaten it like after 4 o'clock. After 4 o'clock, I don't eat anything. But all you have to do is start looking at what's driving the state, and you will find it's either a misunderstanding, a distortion, or internal representation that the brain is so sure is doing it. Who... who has something they want to kind of bring up? Come on up. What's your name?
Deja.
Hi, Deja. Nice name, Deja. I'm Joe.
I'm coming up here with...
Yeah, yeah, sit over
Hi.
This is Deja, everybody. We're very good friends. I put her in the audience. I paid her to come up. You come up. I'm looking around.
Okay.
Now it's recorded.
I'm great, thank you. Good. I'm enjoying your course.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I'm glad it's helpful. Yeah.
It is very much so.
And the reason why I'm not nervous when I do this, you know why? Is because my internal representation is that when I come here. My intention is my internal representation. So that feels good, that. So I'm already feeling that when I come up here. If my internal representation was Lucy in my mind, right, I wouldn't be a place of giving. I would be a place of manipulating and taking. Does that make sense? Because I'm already feeling good and helpful and in a state of intention rather than neediness. And that's what that's why the behavior changes and the results change. So what issue? We'll see. Some issues are longer than others, so we'll see if this is appropriate.
Father.
Okay.
Daddy issues.
Daddy issues. And how's that represented? Like, how do you know you have daddy issues?
It's been a challenge with communication since childhood, and scripts and stories that I have perceived, you know, that have been burdensome.
Gotcha.
And it's carried into adulthood.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm.
So in the internal representation, by the way,
it's usually frozen because of a significant emotional event. So if I go up in front of a bunch of people and I see this pattern of energy and my body feels uncomfortable because I don't have pleasant faces, that pattern gets stuck in my brain and connected to the autonomic nervous system of fight, flight, or stress at the very least. Does that make sense? So the other way it gets stuck is the pattern that goes in, and instead of learning from it, we create a limiting belief that no one cares. It's a limiting belief is nothing more than a decision we make to decide that this pattern of light and energy, this autonomic nervous system, this hormonal system or endocrine system means something. And then we trap it because the brain goes, oh, this is a meaning. So we become these meaning makers rather than intention machines. An intention machine holds an image and just uses feedback to get there. A meaning maker traps an image, and then we wish and hope it goes away. Meanwhile, we keep deleting, distorting, and generalizing. So what is the communication issue that you're having? Like, how does it happen today in your life? How does it reflect, how does it manifest in your life today?
Well, there's a lack of it. I feel like I did my best to set examples as to how I need to feel loved,
right,
and to receive love, how I need to hear it from him to really believe that, and then, you know, with trust. So there was an instance where I called, and he's never been dependable, so I've just been, I don't have high expectations of him coming through.
Gotcha.
And does this show up with relationships as well with some people? Do you attract those people?
Yes. Yes.
Because you will delete the people who actually want to listen to you.
What is up with that, man?
Yeah.
So
this is what's up with that man. You ready? What's up with this is the brain will only look for what's important. And if something is troubling us, that becomes more important than things we like and prefer. If nothing is troubling us, then we will only attract what we prefer, because that's what it does. It looks for what we like, and it wants to attract more of it. But if something's troubling us, we will look for only that. Here's an example of this, what I realized is. So oftentimes a guy or a woman will come to me and say, why did I attract this guy, for example? Why did I attract this man in my life? My dad was perfect. I thought, you know, if you have daddy issues, you didn't have daddy issues, you would attract a good man. I said, tell me about your mother. And she realized she married a mother. Why? Because daddy was so perfect, there was no emotional charge there. Mom's energy was never worked out in this situation, so mom's energy needed to be worked out. It's almost like the subconscious needs to work out any pattern that was important that we couldn't accept, didn't process, and didn't release. Does that make sense? Are you ready in front of all these people here to release this issue, even here today?
Yes.
Are you willing?
I am so willing.
How will you know we're successful?
I'm going to believe in this moment right now.
Cool. And how will you know in the future that we, like, you did something that suddenly you can go, wow, I don't have that problem anymore. What would happen?
I see results in the people I attract and feeling. For me, it's feeling.
Good. So you see this? This is her evidence procedure. That's what we're going to get into in a minute. When you want an outcome, you should always know what it's going to be like. Some people need an experience. Some people need a feeling. This feeling is what we're going to go for. So I just want you to assume somewhere in place and time, your intention is that feeling. And everything from here to that feeling is just process that your subconscious mind's doing, and you could just let it all happen because it's a good thing for you, yes?
Yes.
Okay.
Great.
Okay. So could you close your eyes for me and tell me, and get to the pattern that disturbs you most, that triggers a sensation in your body?
Silence.
Ah. So what has happened is the child has an autonomic nervous system, and it's looking for things that are dangerous or, you know, curious. It's looking for novelty, but novelty that could be dangerous or interesting, right? So all of a sudden, when someone's quiet, it triggers a little bit of a stress response. If nothing's done with that stress response, we either hold it, and now we have a pattern, or we create a limiting belief around it. Does this make sense? So Silence, yes? Okay. When you think about the silence, get in touch with that internal representation. In fact, I'm going to get in touch with it. You can open your eyes.
Okay. Yeah, that's not cool. I don't like that. I prefer you to use your words and communicate with me. Oh, what's another way you can communicate?
Yeah, right here. Where's the feeling? Chest or
yeah.
First thing I want you to do is just give us some room. So I want you to imagine you're putting a door, and that energy that got stuck was supposed to leave.
So just let it leave. Now close your eyes and just know, you don't have to remember, just know you are at the root of that memory pattern where you thought that it meant something. You gave it a meaning. Now what meaning, what decision did you give this moment in time? It could have meant 8 million things. Someone could have had diarrhea, someone could have a problem with intimacy, someone could have constipation, someone could not know what to say to people that he doesn't relate to if it's not a certain subject matter. It could mean 8 million things, and that child internalized it. So what decision did you make that this means I, nobody, everybody, this is the generalization?
That he doesn't care.
Okay. And because he doesn't care, that means what about you? I am
unimportant.
Bingo. So a bunch of fragmented data coming at the system, and we decided it meant something rather than learn from it. Does that make sense? So I want you to close your eyes and really connect to that energy, even the root of that. Just know you're at the root. Mm-hmm. Roughly what? 4 years old? 6 years old? What is it? Roughly?
I'd say
like
nine.
Okay, nine. Okay. So nine,
a moment was happening and a decision was made that created internal representation of a quiet person, right? If she was dating a Buddhist monk, he might be so present with her, and that still will be a problem because it will trigger that pattern, right? So just stay right here. Just stay right here with it. Okay, now, first thing I want you to do is just be with it for a second and ask yourself, just because a pattern of light and sound is hitting your eyes, right? Not even your ears, your eyes. Do you need tension in your body? Do you need to hold your breath? Can you let your body do the processing rather than you? Good. Now just allow it to watch the scene and just be okay with the scene for a moment because it's just a moment in time. When the brain goes, no, it's always been like that. But this moment is just a moment in time. So just stay with this moment. Now in this moment, right now, is he ignoring you? And you, right this moment, right in front of you, right now in reality, in the physical world. So who's really dismissing you, you or him?
At this point. Yeah. Exactly. So you're actually creating your own abandonment now.
See, someone could do something to us, but if it lasts more than a second after they're gone, we're responsible for that creation. Yeah. The wow is right. You'd be surprised how we do this to ourselves. So take that image. Now, we're not saying he's going to change. We're not saying they're going to do anything. We're talking about the now. Okay. In the now, would you rather ignore yourself with that image called the male energy, or would you rather love yourself and listen to you and care about you and pay attention to you?
Yeah, I need all of that.
Good. So take the existing image. Yes. And first thing we have to do is give images a right to be because we freeze them. So to drain the color out of that image. It's just a pattern of energy. It's not him. Drain the energy out of it. Got it? Good. Shrink it until it's about an inch high. And then see you shrinking with it. This is the pattern of energy. And the real you is this awareness, consciousness that just steps right over it. Don't step on you guys. Just walk right over it. Now, I want you, for no other reason but because another pattern of state feels better. So I want you to give yourself what you do want. See the image of being heard. Good. Being seen. Breathing comfortably with you. When the brain goes, that's not going to happen, you say, I'm not trying to make anything happen. I'm giving myself what I want. I'll let the world do what the world does. I'm responsible for my internal representation. Because if I don't even have that image and that feeling, why would I ever even expect it to happen? Because I'm going to delete it anyway. And if I haven't, I really don't need it to happen because what I really want is the state. So stay with the state. and noticed that the problem wasn't that you weren't important. The problem was you made a decision to decide that this moment meant you were unimportant. That was the issue, the decision you made. Can you make a new decision based on an intention that feels good rather than, right, as you're there, an intention that feels good, good. So notice that when you have an intention, do you build a chair right away or a building right away? No, but you don't care because the intention alone feels good, right? Good, let that energy leave. Now really internalize what you want until you have such a positive state that you can give a shit if anybody's listening to you. You can be in a Buddhist, you know, Tibetan cave and you're happy for feeling this forever while people in the impermanent world with their own problems, with their own issues, with their own fears, with their own needs, with their own desperations, with their own hurts, come and go through you while you're staying here. Good, take another deep breath. Good, now go a little bit deeper into receiving it. And now notice how you feel when you look at me now. Who has the problem, you or me? Who really has the problem? You or me right now in this situation?
I have a problem.
Yeah, I'm the one who's uncomfortable, right? So can you have almost empathy for me? Because you're not holding what I am? Mm-hmm.
Yes, I see differently. Thank you.
So you can take this to such, I work at the rehab, you know, they're actually studying what we're gonna do over there because the people, our results are off the scale. Because we go after the stuff. This is what we do here at HMI as a hypnotherapist. This is what we do as NLP trainers. And this is how you change your life, by going into the patterns. Now, here's the interesting thing about patterns. I can give you a pattern with alcohol or cocaine, and you will throw up, right? Because the pattern has changed the coding. But if that pattern is driven by another pattern because that's a coping mechanism, then the internal pattern of loneliness or abandonment or shame that's driving the addiction needs to be unraveled. So this is believe me, it's not easy what I'm saying, but it's powerful. I have
I do not understand that part.
Okay, what part?
The interconnection of when this is going through that part.
Yes, okay, cool. Let me explain that. If I just like something, donuts, I have an internal representation when I see a donut. It will look probably like over here. It might have color, right? If I drain the color out of that donut and shrink it, and especially put it in the same coating of like a fruitcake that I don't like, if I put in the same coating, like maybe fruitcake lives over here and it's like black and white and it's tiny, if I put a donut there, I cannot eat a donut. It's impossible. Right? You won't be able to, you lock it in and you can't eat it. All you have to do is see a donut and do this and you can't eat it. Right? But people say like, yeah, I did it, but it didn't work. The reason why it didn't work is because that donut represents not just a pleasant sensation and habit, but a coping mechanism for whenever I'm sad and this feeling comes up, I think a donut is gonna save me.
God, like anchoring.
What's that?
Like anchoring?
Hangry?
Anchoring.
Oh, anchoring, yes, I'm sorry. I thought you were saying like hangry, angry, anchoring, yes. Okay. But what's happening, the trigger of I'm sad comes to the surface. I was told I'm not allowed to release that sadness, so I say it's bad, because I gave it a meaning, I'm alone. And then I feel uncomfortable, and my brain learns how do I release the discomfort? So now it starts sending dopamine and craving to something that either worked or thought it worked or might work. So that's where advertising comes in, where I'm gonna promise you something that you're gonna need. I'm gonna remember something. This is where addiction happens oftentimes, which is you have a drink and the stress levels drop. So you can change to some modalities of alcohol, like, oh, I don't like it. But if it's a coping mechanism for an emotion, then the brain says, well, what are we going to do with this anxiety? We need to release the anxiety with a drink. Well, what's the anxiety coming from? And then you have an internal representation of that. I'm alone, but I am alone. No, you're not. It's an internal representation. Let me give you an example of alone. So I'm in my house. I had a family once. And I had my wife and two kids were out of town. And they were gone, and all of a sudden I got hit with this loneliness, and I thought, for all these years, was I just using them to cover my loneliness? They're gone for 2 days, and I feel so alone in my house. And I got flooded with this lonely feeling. So I realized it's an internal representation. Why? Because everything is relative. When does loneliness end? There are people down the street. Okay, if they're, what, a foot in front of my house, how about at the door? How about in the door? Then when, they're through the door, now I'm not lonely anymore? It's an internal experience, it's not real. So I started just feeling like alone because as a child, there was some pattern where I was alone in my house, maybe, and I remembered this look, and it triggered a stress response in my body. So my brain is going, this is bad, because as a child, loneliness can mean death. In fact, everything to the child is death, a potential death. So it says, we better do something. So I stopped. I said, what's my internal representation? People far away, I'm alone. Okay, so I just, first of all, I changed space, because another internal representation, and I made everyone really close. So the bars and the restaurants weren't like half a mile away. They were literally outside my door. So I changed that internal representation. Why? Because it's all in my mind anyway. Richard Bandler said, we create imaginary solutions for people's imaginary problems, right? So I changed that internal representation. Then I said, well, what internal representation would change this physiology? People, a lot of people being in the house, right? So I changed the internal representation as if everyone was in the house until I felt connected, happy, safe. Then I let go of the image and I stayed in the state. Follow? Now I'm in this happy state. Now guess what happens? Unconsciously, I don't even remember doing anything. That's when the unconscious kicks in to create the internal representation to your liking. So then all of a sudden, I either called someone or someone called me, those things happen, and I'm having a conversation at a coffee shop with a friend, and it's so deep and wonderful, but it wasn't an attempt to escape the discomfort, which I would have never felt. I would have had coffee, and let's go get a drink or something. Let's do something. We gotta do something because it's not quelling the discomfort. Now that the comfort and the internal representation was creating its own experiences, rather than my negative internal representation and this feeling, me trying to create a change in my environment, manipulate my environment to get rid of it, to no avail, obviously. We know how that happens, right? You try to change things, you still don't feel good. You get the money, the relationship, you still feel alone. It doesn't really work that way. So when you change it inside, then the subconscious takes care of the rest. The subconscious will always want to create the most dominant internal representation. So we're going to take a quick break, and then I'm going to talk about, after a little bit more of this, I'm going to talk about goal setting and how this ties into having an internal representation of what you want, rather than projecting all those patterns of what your brain is so sure is going to happen, which is a pattern recognition device. Okay, is this helpful so far?
Yeah.
You getting? Oh, good, good, good. I got a lot of yeses. That's a good internal representation. I'll keep it. All right, thanks, guys.
Everything's a bit brighter, everything's a bit clearer, everything is easier to deal with when I'm with you. I don't need pills or plastic, it's all fantastic when you turn on the light in my mind. When you turn on the light, turn on the light. When you turn on the light, when you turn on the light,
Hi, and welcome back. Okay, so these internal representations have deeper filters, and we're filtering everything through our internal representation of reality. We have an internal representation of time. Do you know you have an internal representation of time? It's the craziest thing. Who wants to come up here and demonstrate their time, the internal representation of time? Anyone here? Come on up. What's your name?
Hope.
Hope.
Yeah.
I hope we get to find your internal representation of that. So we all hold time in a structure. It's not real. We create it. We create space in our minds. We create time. We create words. We meanings around words. And so you're going to see that even your idea of the past and the future is illusory. It's created in your own mind. I'm going to show it to you because I think hope is suggestible here, and I think we'll be able to get to it fast.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Sleep! Good. So, okay, Hope. So, when you think about, oftentimes people have an internal representation of time that helps us to know where the future actually lives. And people say, I just know. You don't know. You have an internal representation that tells you where the future is. Just like, they bug me how. I don't know how. You have an internal image of them bugging you. We just are unconscious of it. And that's what our job is to start bringing our awareness into the patterns that are creating our issues and change them. So, when you think about the past, where does it live? Like, point to something that happened yesterday. Where would you point if you thought about it as yesterday?
Today, I haven't slept yet.
Okay, you haven't slept yet.
Yeah.
Today. I haven't slept yet either. What do you mean?
I was up all night. I didn't go to sleep.
Oh, okay. Are we okay to do this?
You
overwhelmed? Okay, cool. So when you think about something that happened last week, right, and you think about it like it goes into the past somewhere, where would you point to represent the past if you had to point to it? Just make a decision like where it lives.
Tuesday? Or where it lives?
Like directional.
Back
behind you, good.
Yeah.
So what happens is most people have their time behind them, but if you're someone who is very, very much on time, usually very German, you know, very like, or a business person, where time is sequential, you have the past over there, and the future's there. If someone has their timeline like this, I will never be late for them, because time is sacred. So I always imagine, like, Italian is back there, because I'm Italian, the past. Dinner time is a dinner time. When we start eating, we start eating. When we're done eating, we're done eating. A German shows up at an Italian's house for dinner and goes, what are you doing? 5 o'clock, you said dinner. I got to go at 6. It's 7 to 6. What are you doing? No, we said, well, you said 5 o'clock. Yeah, but we eat when we eat. No, we don't eat. It's 5 o'clock, right? So the people who are very much on time has that these people are pain in the butts on vacation. These people say, we're going to wake up at 9, 9:15, we're going to have breakfast, 9:45, we're going to go into jet skiing, and they have to kind of switch it around. And these people usually get are very annoying, not you, we people, because I have my time like that, right? This timeline has, they're kind of like, when it comes to business, people are just waiting all the time for them, you know, oftentimes, not all the time. So, and then your future, where would you point to if you had your future? Okay, right there. Good. So I want you to think about something that you know for sure happened about a month ago. That probably won't happen again, but you know it happened, like a move or... Got it?
Yeah.
Okay. How far back is a month for you? Is it by the door? Is it...
A month? By the VCR, DVD.
See, we even have time in our space, time-space. In terms of, it's by the DVD. Now think about something you know is probably going to happen in a month, that you're pretty sure, certain is going to happen in a month.
Mm-hmm.
And where does that live?
Right by the edge of the board.
The edge of this board?
Yeah.
So she's congruent in her months, right? Right. Now, I want to show you what happens here. I want to show you something really cool. So I want you to imagine you're taking a line all the way from the utero, the moment you're born, through all the timelines, including that moment, right? And then going through you, is it through, like right through you?
Yeah.
and going to the board and going out into your future, all the way hopefully 120 years, right? Keep going, right? And now I want you to see those two vents over there and over there. Got it? It's a giant line. Mm-hmm. In a moment, I'm going to switch. I'm going to do 180. Is that okay? I'm going to take this line and I'm going to turn it. So that's going to be over there, and that memory is going to be over here. You ready?
No.
Okay.
Okay. So
we're taking, there's a long line going from the minute you're born mm-hmm. through that memory right there, through you, through that memory, and continue to go further. So there are other memories over here that will happen in the future, and there's other memories over there that will happen in the past, yeah? Okay, good. So what I'm going to do is imagine I'm a giant. I'm going to take that memory and grab that memory. I'm going to take that giant line, your whole timeline, and turn it so it's reversed. Is that okay? Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm going to duck so it doesn't cut my head off. You ready? So all the way in the back, ready? Now lock it in. Now, doesn't it feel like that is going to happen and that has already happened?
Yeah.
So just by changing the location, hope feels like the thing that already happened is yet to happen, and the thing that's going to happen already happened in the past. Isn't that crazy? Just by changing the position of the image in our head. Could you see how helpful this would be if you put some of your future goals into the past just for a second to feel like, oh, I've done that already, and then project them back into the future so they feel more believable? Is that, oh, we're going to turn it back so you don't go crazy on us, ready? Especially because you haven't slept, you ready? How's that feel? Better? Good, good, good. Thank you. Here's another example of time. You ready? You can go down. Thanks, Hope. Here's another example of time. Everyone think about a deadline you have and where your timeline, where that lives. And think about how far that lives for you. Right? Now, notice how far away it feels that that deadline is. As far as your time. Some people to the right, some people to the left, right? Now, push that deadline out further and further and further away into the future, further away. Doesn't it feel like, oh, I don't have to really do anything? This is where procrastinators put their timelines. They just throw it so far out that when they get news that it's tomorrow, then it hits them in the face, and then they're filled with anxiety. So they don't know how to place it appropriately. They put it so far out that there's no anxiety, not even a little bit anxiety to get going. So now take that same thing and bring it closer and closer and closer and closer and closer. Do you feel the anxiety building? Now it's too overwhelming and you don't want to do anything but have a drink or go to sleep or something, right? Or get something to eat. Now bring it out until there's just enough anxiety where you feel like you got to get going, but far enough away where you're like, wow, I can get a lot done from here, from now to then. And that's the sweet spot that you lock in every time you have a goal. You put, make sure you change that habit and you put it into that spot. Now, here's another way to look at your timeline. Think about something you know for sure that's going to happen, for sure, next week, tomorrow. Got it? Good. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. You said, yeah, maybe I'll try and be there. I'm going to have a party at my house Friday. I'll try to make it. Everyone say, I'll try to make it. Are you going to make it? When you say, I try to make it, I'll try to make it. Are you putting that in your timeline? No, you're putting it like up here somewhere. Now say, I'll be there. What am I bringing? You're bringing $1,000 each in cash. That's an NLP trick. I'm just kidding. How do you feel now? I'll be there. What am I bringing? You notice it drops into your timeline. Now think about winning the lottery in your future. Where does that live? It kind of lives up there. See, when we have goals and we put a goal into our future, we don't put into our future, unfortunately, we put into a future. It's never our future. It's something we're going to do. It's only when the brain notices that you dropped it into your timeline that you're serious, so action needs to be taken now to move closer to that future. Until then, it becomes a fantasy. This is in the law of attraction, which I teach here, which is oftentimes people imagine something and they'll visualize it, they do the vision board, but it'll stay here like some hope rather than something in their future. And this is my future, so my body is learning that every moment has got to get closer. And depending on how close it is in the future, depends on how much action this body needs to start taking. Because if I put something into, like, you know, next year, well, my body starts taking its time. But if I feel like I have to do this within 2 months, my body starts to create more energy because it knows that something is pending and it's close and I have to do something to get there. I don't have to do it, by the way, my body does. It just knows that it needs to start moving. And so I'm not gonna go into all the filters, but do you see how just time alone is a whole construct? Space is the same way. Claustrophobia is nothing more than a pattern of energy that looks like this rather than like this. And then or people too big, you shrink them. It's just internal patterns that represent everything. Time, space, limiting decisions we made. And here are the basic three I want to talk about. When we have these internal representations, we have a belief. That's a decision that's made. I'm not enough. Here's about 10 of the most common that I've seen over and over and over again. I'm not enough. I'm not important. I don't fit in. I'm not lovable. I'm weird. I don't know how to do anything. I'm stupid. I'm awkward. I'm alone. I'm ugly. There's a couple more I can't think of. But so as soon as we create a belief system, our brain now deletes and distorts everything through that. So every situation feels exactly the same. Example, I don't do well with women. So you see a 16-year-old kid, ask somebody out on a date first time, doesn't know anything about the girl. She could be in a relationship, her parents might have just passed away. The kid has no idea, right? And he walks over to a girl and says, "Hey, you want to go to the prom?" And she looks at him and goes, "No." Meanwhile, she's like overwhelmed. She never heard anyone say that. And that becomes, ooh, she hates me. So if I have this belief that I don't do well with women or women don't like me, you have a belief. That oftentimes leads to a decision. And this is a decision in itself, which is, there's something wrong with me, and no one likes me. I don't do well with women. That's a decision to give it a meaning. It was a moment. We give it a meaning, and then we make another decision, which is, I'll just never ask a girl out ever again. Never again. Right? So I make a new decision. So who am I going to attract? Women who want me more than I want them. Aggressive people. People with abandonment issues that will come at me, because at least I didn't have to ask her out. Right? Oh, I don't have to worry about it, right? So I make a decision. So this is important because if I have this belief, I see everything filtered through that belief. I delete, distort, and generalize. So I go on a date, and a girl says to me, "You talk too much," right? She doesn't. I don't talk like this on dates. As an example, you talk too much, right? Actually, sometimes I do. So, if they're interested. So you talk too much, right? I see that through, is this something wrong with me? Girls don't like me. I'm repulsive. I don't say, if I have an intention, which is married, on the beach, I love you, more holidays. And if I don't have an intention, if I have an intention, this one moment becomes data. It becomes, "Oh, I talk too much. Oh, I'm so sorry. Forgive me. I thought you were interested. I was getting excited. I'm sorry. You're right. Tell me about you." Right? It just becomes and if she has an issue with it and gets up and leaves, I say no to myself. She has an issue with it. I can stop it. And some people have an issue with it. So the next one, I will not only not talk, but I'm sure she won't have an issue with it. Right? But no, I don't learn from it because I already have my belief. This means something wrong with me. and then meet another girl. I see pictures of her exes, and every one of them is filled with tattoos and piercings. Every one of them. And then I filter that as, I'm milquetoast for her. I'm boring. I'm conservative. Ugh, I'm a real dud. Girls don't like me. And I meet another girl. And she just doesn't call me back. I don't know she went to back to her ex. I don't even bother asking. She didn't call me back. I'm just not lovable. So every one of these experiences became what? The same exact creation. Here, every one of these is just data. It's feedback, getting closer to the end result. This is what happens when we make a decision. I read something that I disagreed with. Because someone said in the law of attraction or create your reality kind of stuff, they say, if you want to know your belief systems, look at your life. But that's kind of ridiculous. Because sometimes things happen. If I get hit by a car, or sometimes when I'm starting a business before I become a billionaire, I'm living in my car. So what, my life, my belief systems are I'm broken and I'm homeless for the rest of my life? No. The real way of putting it, to my opinion, is if you want to know your belief systems, look about how you feel about your present moment. What you believe about your present moment is your belief. I can't, I don't know how, no one likes me, I'm alone, I don't fit in. That's the meaning we're giving the moment rather than just seeing it as data to adapt, to move through, to learn, to communicate, and get closer to our goal. Does that make sense? So you find your belief system by asking yourself, what do I believe about this? Money's always going out. There you found it. There are plenty of people, I get when I have a bill, money goes out. I don't go, money's going out. So obviously this is a belief system. So because it's a belief system, it looks for proof. So then go, look, I found the proof. And it deletes the contrary information, right? Conflicting data, right? I don't believe that. I don't see that. And then it actually will eventually create it. And it will create it. You could be in a monastery with monks, and if you have an internal representation that you always get slighted, you'd be there, oh, namaste, 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 namaste. Oh, beads, oh, get everyone first, get everyone, thank you, namaste. I organize this, namaste. Rinpoche, Rinpoche, namaste. The beads, you don't have any more, I said there was 10. I actually wrote the thing. I said 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, and a 10. You don't have any? So you don't have, you can't get them? Oh, we're going to meditate now, are we? Because everything will be filtered through that perception. Everything. It will delete. It will distort. And it will generalize everything. It's like magic. When you switch it, it becomes magic. So, we're good here. So what's important is your beliefs and your decisions are very important, and also your values. What are values? Values are those things that we never really live up to. We can never really live up to. It's what's important to us. So if you get someone's values, you can read them like a psychic. You show me someone's values around a certain thing, and I'll show you their experiences. What does that mean? If in career, my number one value is money. Number two is power. Number three is travel. Number four is flexible hours. I'll show you someone who's got a lot of money, and everyone hates and everyone's suing. Because if my highest value is money, then I don't really care if you like my product, if you need, that's most important. That's first. I don't care if you need the product. I don't care if you like the product. I don't care if the product breaks. I don't really care. I'm just trying to get money out of you, right? But conversely, if you have highest value is making a difference, integrity, camaraderie at work, flexible hours, good working environment, pleasant, you know, environment, vacation time, being respected, and money's down here, I'll show you someone who loves their job. And they would love to live at work if they could, but they're living hand to mouth because they don't have money high enough. So money should be around three. if it's not because of some decision that was made, some emotional charge around it, some internal representation that money is bad or I can't have it, then it might stay down and be too far below on your values list. Same with relationships. If you have a relationship where sex is number one, right? I'll show you someone who has fiery, wonderful, hot relationships in the beginning and then always teeters out because other values all of a sudden fall apart. You have someone whose highest value is connection, friendship, sense of humor, adventurous, education, tenderness, kindness, and then sex. I show you someone who you love hanging out with but never have sex with. And this is what happens. They want sex at usually around three, or you know, you don't want it too high, but you don't want it too low. Okay. Unless you're okay with that. But then you can't complain that you don't have what you want if it's not part of your value system. And if it's not, you got to bring it up as important with creating new internal representations of it. Does that make sense? So with that, I'm going to go into the principles of success. Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay. The first principle of success, and I'm going to say it, you're going to hear it, and you'll delete it. Because you won't... Unless you do this already, well, you do it in some areas of your life, so you have to be aware that you do it in other areas of your life. Unless you have an internal representation of your outcome, knowing your outcome, unless you know your outcome, nothing changes. Why? Because the brain is an automation device. It's an efficiency machine. It will not change automated outcome unless a wrench is thrown into it. And you say, hey, we're doing something else today. We're going to start burning energy. Unless you make a decision to go to San Francisco, all the I should go to San Francisco, all the I think San Francisco might be nice, all the unconscious patterns of going to work are just going to take over, and San Francisco will never happen. So unless you make a decision, you're going to San Francisco, and you know what that is, and you know what the end is. Your brain has nowhere to go unless you know what the end is. Why? Because you don't go to San Francisco and suddenly you see the sign, welcome to San Francisco, and stop driving, do you? You don't stop. You know your outcome is that hotel or your friend's house. You know when I pull up to the hotel, I will stop this intention, this intentional behavior, so I can go back to automated behavior, the hotel, the TV. But until then, I can't be automated. I have to be awake, moving somewhere. And the brain wants to put us back to automated sleep because in order to change anything, it has to burn energy, glucose. And in order to do that, I mean, when it does that, it feels like it's going to die. So unless you keep the intention and you keep reframing the discomfort as good, it's going to hijack you and get you back to where you were driving before. It was just unless you make a decision that this is where we're going and every moment's moving there, the brain will try and hijack you and you'll say, oh God, I was going to go to San Francisco and I was driving, I went to work instead. I went to my friend's house, I go to every day. So it knows when you're serious. So the first thing you need to do is know your outcome. What does that mean to know your outcome? You have to think of it as an end result that already exists somewhere that you're now going to keep going until you physically create it. Think of this chair for a second. Could you imagine building the chair without knowing what the chair looked like? You'd just be hammering wood and gluing wood together. What would you be doing if you didn't have the outcome? How would the brain know to change things? How would the brain know to try this and try that and come up with new ideas and new ways of getting there to this out if you don't even have the outcome? So most of us don't even do this. And then we complain that our lives are the way they are when we don't even know where we're headed. Why? Because the brain deletes this as even a possibility. So it doesn't even have an image of what we want because it doesn't even think it's possible. So what we really are normally saying is, I just don't like my present situation, my internal representation, and the feeling in my body, and I just, please give me something, tell me what to do to make it go away. That's what we're really saying. That's why we confuse outcomes with states. A state of being I can feel right now. I don't need a chair. I don't need a person. I don't need money to change my state. That's just an outcome. That's an intention that I can feel good moving towards. Does that make sense? That unless you have all five senses of how it would look, your brain doesn't know what you're doing. It doesn't go into a state of creation or intention. It stays in a state of automation. And we'll see this as hypnotherapists will say, tell me what you want. I want a relationship. What does it look like? Oh, you know. Now tell me, what do they look like? I don't know. Well, I don't know. Who knows? You know, I'm just tired of being alone. Is that an internal representation of what they want? Tired of being alone? Do you see a positive internal representation of what they want when they say tired of being alone? What's their picture? Alone. So how's the brain going to create not alone? It creates some positive pictures. I hate being overweight. What's the internal? I don't know. I just hate being overweight. I'm just tired of the dating scene. I'm tired of living hand to mouth. So what happens is we spend so much time in the discomfort of our present situation because we don't even feel like we even have the right to put our awareness and our feelings on what we would like. So we just spin, hoping through the academic model, which is not good or bad, it's a certain system, or a worker bee model, which is, if I do what I need to do, you will give me something. What do I need to do? Vision board, what do I need to do? Go out and date, look pretty, look good, look. What do I need to do to get this thing that I don't even know what it is? I just know we'll get away, get rid of this discomfort in my body. Does that make sense? And this is where the internal representation and that core moment starts. So when we're born, or just our natural essence, is a feeling of positive expectancy and gratitude. It's symbiotic. It's not like I'm expecting something. I'm just, you know, anything's possible. And whatever I think about, I feel good about, right? So I don't want things to give me a feeling. I feel good, and I just want to intend something that feels good for me to intend. It's like a cruise ship. I feel great, but if I don't know where I'm going, it's kind of weird, wandering aimlessly. But if I know I'm going to Bali, that'd be fun, but then I can enjoy the cruise ship. So I'm in a good mood, and then I want to take this happy mood somewhere. So we're going in the lower happy way, and everything, like I said before, is feedback, yes? So everything is feedback. I'm trying different things, which is step number two, which is be flexible. I'm trying different things. I'm not talking so much next time. I'm changing my hair color. I'm communicating. I'm asking more questions. I'm gaining weight. I'm losing weight. I'm doing whatever it takes to move closer to a goal that, based on data, not based on fear, on data, right? So all of a sudden, a moment happens on the way there, and instead of it being data, it now becomes a belief. Instead of being emotion processing, and now it becomes hurt. You with me? Now I have this feeling in me. Ah. Now I have this energy and this internal representation. So instead of this being my internal representation, this is now my internal representation. Does that make sense? This feeling of frustration, sadness, or hurt that was just a moment is now my state of being. So now I think that goal, I think that this goal is going to get rid of this feeling and give me back this feeling. So now I'm in angst, not desire. I'm in craving rather than creation. As the Buddhist backgrounds, this is where aversion and attachment comes from. Now I have an aversion and now I'm attached to this outcome to make me happy, as opposed to I just have pure desire, not the desire the Buddhists talk about as far as craving and suffering, but desire that comes from like, oh, let's do it, it'll be fun, we'll figure it out, we'll keep going. It's a positive state of being, right? So now I spend my life trying to get rid of this internal picture. So guess how the brain creates? It's like Lester Levinson said, the brain is like an oven, it bakes what you put in it. So if you put a shoe in it, it's gonna bake it. You put a cake in it, it'll bake it. So now what is the brain baking and creating unconsciously? The thing you said you want or this? Now it starts deleting this, distorting and generalizing life to only see this. And then we're trying to fight to get this. So this is where force comes in and manipulation. And we can change our lives. I can threaten people. I can charm people. I can manipulate. I can work hard to get this, but I'm still feeling this anyway. And then when I'm asleep at the wheel, my subconscious wants to create this and say, surprise. There's that scene again. Just that person you got now left you, and now that feeling's there again. There, I was right. And then we go, oh, it's always there. I've been in a relationship for 40 years. They cheated yesterday. They're a cheater. Wait a minute. You've been together 40 years. They cheated once. Yeah. So how are they a cheater? They broke their ankle about 10 years ago. You didn't say they're an ankle breaker. Why is that? Because it was always there. Betrayal, always there. Hurt, it was always there. It was just waiting to manifest itself. So you can go, you see, no matter what I did, it showed up. If it wasn't in here, you wouldn't even notice it. So your husband, wife cheated, someone left, you'd go, what happened? You like someone else? It wouldn't be a big deal. It would just be information. What's the matter? You lost a job. What happened? Oh, you didn't. I wasn't performing? Huh, I think I was performing. Oh, this must be something else going on. It's information. But when we have a belief, we go, aha, this is what it is. Because the meaning was already there. We don't create it. After about nine, everything is just recycled. It's like plants. We plant seeds until we're about 9 or 10, and then they grow into flowers, and they bloom their own seeds, and we keep recreating our experiences over and over again because we don't plant anything new. And that's what hypnosis is about at NLP, is implanting new patterns to grow. So you all with me still? Yeah. So first thing is know your outcome. Second is be flexible. If something doesn't work, just try something else. But if you know your outcome, guess what? If you know it, your body's going to naturally want to try something else. When a baby sees something walking or talking, they hear the word water, and their mouth goes, koko. My son used to say, noko, for his blanket. Blanket, noko, right? So he used to say, noko, noko, right? But the brain knows what the person is knowing, what the baby is knowing. It's water, right? Someone's saying water, and they're going, koko, kika. So they keep going, kuka, papa. Pooba, papa. The brain naturally is trying different things. Let's try this. Juju, no. Waba, waba sounds closer. Wee wee, wee wa waba. Papa, papa, ta, tabwa, wata, wa wata, 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 wata. And then a flood of dopamine connects and it remembers the neural networks that created water, and then it goes, water, water, water. Then we think we say the word water. No, our brain took hours and hours and days to do it. And then we go, oh, I do it, because it happens now fast for us. The servant is responding in seconds rather than hours. And then now we think we're doing it. Does that make sense? So when you're flexible, because you know your outcome, your body gets to try different things that are outside its already existing know-how, and therefore creates new opportunities to try new ideas, new insights. We talk about being in a physiology, and psychology and physiology of excellence, number three. Just feel confident, just call it confidence. But being in a physiology and psychology of excellence means that you're in that state of positive expectancy, you have the right internal representation, you're feeling a feeling of appreciation, and you have this feeling of positive expectancy because you're flexible trying things to get closer to your goal. So you're excited about it. Does that make sense? Number four is take action. Duh. If you have an outcome and you're feeling great, why wouldn't you take action? If you're not, it's because you either are not very clear and that goal is not compelling enough to want to burn energy. That's what an action is, burning energy to get there. Or you don't know what action to take. And this is what happens. One of the biggest mistakes people make is they have a goal, they start thinking about it, and then because they don't know what to do or how to do it or where to start, they actually drop the goal. Could you imagine when you learn to walk and you're down here, right? And you go, oh wow, that looks really cool. Everyone's just going to the food so fast that way. They just walk. And they get the food, and then they go over there, and they play with their toys. And I want that. I want in on that. I want in on that. I want in on that. Well, how do I do that? What's the first thing I do? I don't know. I'll forget it. the actions start to happen. Actions start to happen when the brain is ready. And the brain gets ready to try things, being flexible, taking action. Once the internal experience that we want of that outcome is so internalized, so enjoyed, so appreciated that the body and brain wants in on this experience that it doesn't have right now. Let me give you an example of this. It's called motivation. And since we're at the Motivation Institute, right? Hypnosis Motivation Institute, it's a perfect example. Do you ever have a friend of yours say, oh, you should watch Game of Thrones or Breaking Bad, oh, it's the greatest show. And you know it's gonna be good because everyone's talking about it, but you're just not motivated. Because your brain has all these other patterns, and to break any pattern, you have to burn energy. The brain doesn't want to burn energy unless it's really important, fire or desire. So you go, I really should, I really should, I really should, I really should. That doesn't ever, I never saw the word, you never see should moving a cell in a petri dish. It's fire or desire, right? It's food or a toxin, right? That's what moves us, right? So I'm, so then you, then one day, through the confluence of several different, you know, things that happen that day, you happen to have the show on. And you watch it. And you register that you like something. Someone's attractive in it. It's funny, compelling, curious, suspenseful. And so now that you registered, you liked it. Not you want it, you liked it. The brain has remembered that, and its job is to create dopamine and remember the patterns that you liked, so it makes you do it again, even against your own will. So then the next night, you come home, you have to do your homework or whatever, you have a paper, whatever, and then you come home, and your brain goes, I just gotta, and you can't help but do it. You're compelled to do, you have a craving. After three or four times of really enjoying it, you can't think of anything else but Game of Thrones when you come home. And then you're binging for 7 hours. Why? Because the dopamine is connected to this reward, pleasant, but it started by feeling that it was a pleasant experience. So unless you are liking your goal first, not wanting it, receiving that goal first, enjoying that lover, enjoying that money, enjoying that vacation, enjoying that career, unless you're experiencing it first, there's no motivation to do it again. So you have to either experience it for real or imagine by using all five senses and enjoy the outcome and start to fantasize about it at first. Once you fantasize about it, the brain starts to go, hey, I want in on that. And if you don't interrupt it by how, when, or where, it will start scanning the environment for patterns that match that internal representation. I've seen it happen where I'm sitting there. This is worth telling the story about. Right? So here's a perfect example of how intention is created, especially when you don't know what to do. See, if you know what to do, it's easy. I know how to go to the gym. I know how to not eat. I know how to get an A on a paper. But if you don't know where to start, are you starting a business? You want to be a musician? And you don't know where to start, you just give up usually. So one day I was, my son was, you know the Halo video game, Halo? He wanted to be this creature called the Elite. It has red eyes and it's a pointy head and this creature, right? And he said, I want to be there for Halloween. He was very young, and he said, I want to be there for Halloween. And I said, oh, let's look it up. I go, look online. They only have the different character called Master Chief, right? They don't. It's not a creature. It's like a guy with a helmet. He goes, I don't want that. I want the Elite. I was like, but they don't have it. He goes, come on, let's do it. I said, but I don't have it. He goes, let's build it. I said, I don't know how to build this stuff. He goes, well, let's intend it. We went to the moon. He used my own stuff back at me. So now he cornered me into my highest valley. I said, but Nick, I don't. I can't say I don't know how. Obviously, I don't know how. That's not my job. My job is what, not the how. I look at this creature, and arts and crafts is like heart surgery to me. I'm probably better at being a heart surgeon than building something like that. I'm looking at this creature with red eyes and a pointy head. I'm And like 8 times, let's go get ice cream. Or I even called a friend of mine at Special Effects and I was gonna have them build it. It was like $3,000, I actually considered it. And probably the only reason why I didn't pay for it is because they said it would probably take too long and it would be finished. But that's how desperate I was. I was ready to spend $3,000 on a costume, so I couldn't get out of my highest value. So I said, okay, is that me? And that sound happens, it just means learning is happening to everyone, deep learning. So I'm looking at this creature and I kept turning away and I said, what would I tell a client? Know my outcome, that's my outcome. This is my end result. I felt the nice feeling of having it. And as soon as my brain said, well, what do we do? I said, it's not my job to know what we do. It's my other brain's job to know what to do. It's not mine. I'm just gonna hang out with it. And I just hang out. And eventually I stopped running away because I didn't know what to do. I just enjoyed it. And I just trusted that nothing may happen, something could happen, but I was doing my job, which I stated my intention, started liking it, started enjoying it, started imagining it, and just doing that. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, is the first thought that came while I was in the intention rather than escaping from the intention, like ice cream or something. All of a sudden, I remembered my tile guy who just put these travertine tiles down. You know when you have the square, like cardboards, right? Cardboard to separate the tile. He said, do you want to save this for a school project? Like, but this felt like it was 2 weeks ago. And I said, no, just throw it in a recycle bin. And I said, why did that image? It wasn't like a eureka moment. Right, it's cardboard squares, but I was like, why did that come up while doing this? So I go and look, and sure enough, they were still in the recycle bin. So it must have been 7 days ago, not 10 days ago. But I'm looking at a piece of cardboard, and I'm looking at it, and all of a sudden, I'm just looking at it, I'm like, da, 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 and I just kept staying with my intention. I said, I don't have to know how, I don't know how, I just know the what, and I like it, and I'm enjoying it, I'm in a great mood, physiology and psychology of excellence, confidence, knowing, and just a feeling of enjoying the outcome, and just feeling like a time in my life where just everything worked out, whatever state that is. And then suddenly I accidentally bend it, and it goes to an A-frame, and I realize it's the same shape as the creature's head. Well, that's interesting. So then I thought, well, if I had scissors and just cut this, I'd have the same top. So I thought, I didn't even think of spray paint. I was like, oh, I can spray paint it red. And then little black, like bullet marks. That would be cool. And then I was like, well, what am I going to do with the top? And then all of a sudden, all these things started. I remembered a Halloween scream mask I had in my garage that I was working out like 2 weeks ago and was in the corner, like getting, you know, in the corner of... collecting dust, thank you. It was collecting dust. And I remember, oh wow, that can be like a mask. And I have a background in electronics, so I was like, oh, two LEDs popping through the mat in the black. And then he's got this head, oh wait, I just, more cardboard, put the jaw around. And then I was like, oh my God, a bodysuit. And then all of a sudden I remembered my neighbor who gave me a glue gun like 2 years ago. I didn't even know what a glue gun was. And she gave me this glue gun and I put it in a drawer and I remembered it out of nowhere. And I took out the glue gun, I figured out how to work it. And I realized I can glue certain things onto the, and then all the cardboard were like his armor. You know, we started painting. And I thought, oh, elastic, I can, and suddenly, like after 3 days, he's the elite character. Like just by holding my intention and keep releasing tension and judgment and not leaving because I didn't know what. And that's what most people do. As soon as they don't know what or how, they start feeling the discomfort of not having what they want rather than the appreciation of having it and feeling that discomfort as energy changing to get them what they want. So, physiology of excellence. Take action. Know your outcome. Be flexible. And then just be present to what is. And if you leave, it just means that you don't have... I'm just kidding. No. It's 10. We are still 10:30. Bye-bye. I hope that was helpful. You with me? But let's take this a little deeper, shall we? What I have found is all those other steps are unimportant. All we really, I mean, they're all there, but they're unconscious. We're just bringing unconscious awareness. So if the steps are not present, then you need to bring them to your conscious awareness so they can go back into the unconscious, which is what I found. And I'm telling you, I live my life this way. I tripled my income in 3 weeks. It's a combination of the law of attraction and NLP. And since these principles were here, that's why I got into NLP. And NLP says you have to know your outcome. What is the evidence procedure that tells you that your outcome has been achieved? And your only job, believe it or not, your only job is to put all your awareness on all five senses of that outcome, become enveloped with it, in it, and with it, and through it, and bake in it, and bask in it, and then put it into your future, and know that you're going to have to be flexible, feel things, challenge things, understand things, and learn from things, because your present moment isn't that thing. So when that juxtaposition is very clear, knowing where you're headed, like I was saying about losing weight, I see the number, I see this number, that's not the number I'm seeing, but this is the number that is, it creates a movement wanting to get closer to that number, that end result. And if you break it up into, if this is my goal, so let's say with me, I was 200 pounds, my fighting weight's like 185. 200 to 185, that's 15 pounds, it feels like, So if I say, what number, if I'm 200, what number is the closest, little goals, right? So this is my goal. This will actually create the excitement, because 200, 195 is no, it's not excitement, because there's no result. So I get the excitement here, feel the feeling there, make it compelling, but now it's overwhelming. So I want to break it up into small goals so it feels possible. So now this by itself is not that compelling. I can do it, but there's no motivation, so why do it? This by itself is exciting, but it just feels like it takes too long to get any reward, right? So without these two in place, we have a tendency to drift. When you have your outcome and then you say, what number do I never see? I never see 195. I see 196, 198, sometimes the scale's off, 201, but you never see 195. That was the number. So 195. So I was excited. Then I hit 195. I was like, it was so exciting. Even though it was not the result I wanted, it was rewarding. And then it made me go, what number do I never see? 193. Okay, I'm going to hit 193. And I hit 191. I couldn't believe I was looking at 193. And I was so excited about it, 191. And now so my body's more excited about moving there than eating late at night. And when I'm about to eat, I go, remember that goal? How good is that? This is taking us away from that goal. And so they call it sensory acuity in NLP, which is become aware of if you're getting closer or further from your goal. Become aware of your present moment. Be present now and know what is now. Be brutally honest with where you are now, knowing where you're going and knowing the steps that can get you there. Does that make sense? I'm going to give you another way of doing this, and then hopefully whoever sticks around before 10, doesn't leave before 10, I'll give you a little meditation on this. Is that okay? You're with me, right? It's helpful? Okay. So this is what I found. When someone puts a goal in their future, it feels so good. Again, it's the reason it feels so good is because we think it's going to make us feel good. So of course we put a goal that's unachievable only to crave it and suffer over it, right? So we put it in our future. We don't think it's possible because we think, if I had that, then my problems would go away. But what happens is, when you do this, it doesn't put it in your future. It puts it in a future somewhere. That would be nice. But if you break it down and you go backwards, and you go back to that same principle, and you say, I've done this about three different times. So I'll say, let's say with this work, right? I said to myself, I want to see 40 clients a week. I was seeing two. And I was a nominal session fee. So that's what I wanted. I'm here, that's what I wanted, right? And I got to tell you, I was like, how am I going to get there? I didn't know what to do, how to do it. I didn't even think it was possible. And I started having to be brutally honest with myself. Like, I don't think I can be that guy, so why would I be there? So I had to go backwards. What would get me here? Who'd be a guy that would be here? Someone who's getting amazing results. Okay. But how did they get there? Well, and then I started filling in the blanks. What could have happened to make someone go from here to here? That. Okay, what got them there? They worked with a hairdresser that told 10 people. They learned a new technique, and to me it was using NLP and hypnosis, or what's called MER or timeline therapy, with hypnosis. That started getting results. I could do a talk. I can read a book, get a certification. meet somebody, work at a rehab, treatment center, right? And then suddenly, this felt possible. Does that make sense? And I did this as an actor. I did it twice as an actor. I said, why would they hire me when I was in my 20s, when they had Tom Cruise, Brad Pitt, and Johnny Depp? You know what the answer was? They wouldn't. So no wonder I wasn't motivated. No wonder I wasn't taking action. No wonder I didn't know my outcome. No wonder why I didn't know what to. So then I said, well, how did they get here? Ooh, they had a really small part in a huge movie and got attention. No, that's over here. How did they get here? They were one of the leads in a big movie and they had a lot of leads with them. Okay, how did they get there? They were a small part in a big movie. Great, how did they get there? They had a big part in a tiny movie, like a small movie, a big part, like a, you know, independent. How did they get there? A real independent movie they were starting. How did they get there? They did a bunch of shorts and they did some theater. How did they get there? They worked hard as an actor. Holy cow. Now, this little goal is achievable, but not really exciting. But because it's connected to this, it's very exciting. So suddenly, it becomes my future rather than a future. And everything I put in my subconscious mind up to right about here happened. And then something happened in my life that took me off. And then I did this a different way I can't get into right now. But everything I put in just started happening because my brain said, I want to do that because the reward over here is going to be great. So this is exciting because I can do that and it's connected. If the brain doesn't have a connection, it just feels like this ambiguous thing floating around. Does that make sense? So what you do is you take a goal, you make it compelling, you use all five senses, and you enjoy the hell out of it. You feel it in your heart, you feel it in your cells, you feel it in your lungs, you feel it in your body, and you just appreciate your right to soak in an experience. Now, here's the point here. When you do this, you might hit some discomfort. You know why? Because your existing internal representation contextually around that goal is gonna, and the emotions are gonna start coming up. It's gonna say, how dare you have an image of someone loving you, enduring you? You know that's not gonna happen. You know what normally happens. And that's when you say to your brain, I'm not interested in anything. What could happen, might happen, things can happen, everything happens. I'm just interested in putting my awareness on something and enjoying it. Thank you so much for sharing. And then you go deeper. See, I'd rather love this than judge life, because life is always moving anyway. Moments are always coming and going. No one's going to do this during the holidays or in a fireplace 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for eternity anyway. So I might as well have it inside for eternity and let life come and go. And hopefully life will start to match it, because that's how the brain works. It wants to create more of what I'm already have familiarized myself with. Make sense? So I know we haven't worked on getting a goal, but just think about something you'd like to achieve, even if it feels like it's impossible right now. Something that you would like to achieve, respecting and knowing that there are things that you don't know, that you may have to learn. There may be someone you may have to meet. There may be an idea you may have to have. There may be inspiration, a dream you might have to have, an idea, anything. Got it? You all got one? Just anything for now. I'll just show you how this works. Good. Close your eyes and take three slow, deep breaths. And just as you exhale, just imagine all the tension leaving your body. Now really feel the tension draining out of the heels of your feet like you've opened up valves, and all the tension is draining out of you like sand as you pace it with a very slow, long exhalation. So your awareness should be at the heels of your feet by the time you've exhaled completely. Now, in the next exhalation, continue doing that, but just imagine you're letting go of thousands of balloon strings that represent all the thoughts that you need thought you need to hold on to and judge and squeeze or and identify with in the now. Just let them all just go. And all the sensations in your body, it's your body processing life. They're none of your business. So let go of the tension and judgment around that. Don't try to get rid of those sensations. They're just your body processing things. See them like a river passing through you. Be free. Now, first thing I'd like you to do is think about what you want, but think about what your brain says is that's in conflict with what you want. So if it's money, say, well, this is what we have in the bank. If it's a relationship, well, this is what we have. It's just notice what your brain is telling you. So bring up the problem first. Become aware of the problem. And I ask you a question. This problem, is it happening right here in the now, right in front of you, right now? Chances are the answer is no. So who's really creating the problem right now, you or life? So just notice that what you're doing is projecting a pattern of energy called the brain as a pattern recognition device. It's projecting patterns. So now I want you to drain the color out of that pattern. Why not? It's just right here now. Drain the energy out of it. So it becomes like a hologram. It becomes invisible, less opaque, just invisible. And now shrink it. And now just place your awareness on a desired outcome just for no other reason right now than to feel what it feels like to have it now. And just feel the feelings you think it will give you. You're just giving yourself your own feelings. So just feel yourself being either adored, important, relaxed, grateful, purposeful, free. Just a feeling of, I have a right to have this forever. And just imagine it's a feeling forever you're having. So it's not something you're trying to create. It already exists somewhere in the field of limitless probabilities. And you're just enjoying something forever in the now. Forever. And that this is real. Everything else that is not this is just the patterns of impermanence from the impermanent world coming and going. And go deeper and deeper and deeper. Notice all five senses until every cell in your body is filled with the ecstasy of that experience forever. Why not? You're just giving yourself permission to feel either important, wanted, applauded, needed, included, safe. And anything that is not that pattern is another internal representation. So let that all come and go. Just let go of the old patterns and emotions. Give them a right to come and go. They were just passing at one point in your life. Let them continue to pass like a river. And then go a little deeper into this experience. Now, I want you to imagine you're stepping out of the scene. But before you step out, just love it a little bit more. Use all five senses. See what you're seeing. Why? Because you get to put your awareness on images, which changes your neurology. Hear what you're hearing. Taste what you're tasting. Feel what you're feeling, who's there, what's there, and just experience it. You're not doing it, you're not wanting anything, you're experiencing it. Until every single cell in your body has gotten the message that you rather love this than judge any other patterns. So let any other pattern leave. Let any other pattern have a right to be. That's the world. It will always come and it will always go. Now, step out of that scene. See yourself in the scene. And feel your heart in that scene tethered to your heart as you look at the scene. And keep breathing in the feeling of appreciation for this. As if, like, this is it. You died, and this is eternity, and you get to have this scene forever and ever and ever and ever. And so soak it right into your heart. You're not trying to create anything. You're just being aware of things. Good. Now shrink the scene down, still seeing that tethered string from your heart, like a energy center from your heart to your heart. And you're just breathing in the appreciation. But see the scene now, the size of like an iPad or something. Like three-dimensional iPad maybe. And now, I want you to imagine you're floating up above your timeline and work with your brain and your mind, your subconscious mind. I want you to decide how far in the future do you want to drop this intention so that everything in your body and brain, everything that needs to happen, you're willing to allow to happen so the physical version of this can show up. And so just notice what is reasonable, what is comfortable, what is believable in your timeline, 6 months, a year, 2 years, 5 years, 3 months. And now just as you float into your future, like Superman or Superwoman, you're floating into your future, I want you to breathe in and breathe out and really, really feel the love of this, really spin this feeling of appreciation and gratitude, almost as if you got everything you ever wanted in life, you're exploding with ecstasy and gratitude. Really charge this energy up, charge this scene up, really charge it, really charge it, really charge it as you float right above that moment in your timeline and become aware of the time as if now, right now it is XX 2020 XX. So become aware of the date. Feel that you're in the date of that now. Really say to yourself, it's this date. It's even give it a Monday or a Tuesday if you want. And just really feel it. Now go into the scene one more time and just really say, this is worth it. This is worth it. This is worth putting all my energy towards. And you may have to change this when you go home or tomorrow. That's okay. But for now, this is worth it. And you know that there are things that you're going to have to learn, people you're going to have to meet, things you're going to have to do, things you have to feel, things you have to let go of, things you're going to have to feel and process, things you're going to have to no longer be interested in. But this is worth it. And everything that had to happen got you here. So I want you to now drop that iPad now right into your timeline. Look below, watch it drop into it. And as it drops in, locks in, look at all the things lighting up all the way back to now in the past at HMI. Feel everything lighting up that got you there. Everything lighting up. Now, you're going to get to drop into it now. Drop into the scene. And now drop in there and be there now. Release all tension in your mind and body so your body can release everything it needs to release to give yourself permission to drop into it even more. Now, I want you to notice all the things that had to have happened to get you here. That you needed to happen or it wouldn't have happened. You had to learn something. You had to gain weight. You had to lose weight. You had to learn how to juggle. You had to take a class. You had to get a certification in something. You had to have a dream about something. You had to, a friend had to call you haven't seen in 20 years. A chance meeting and some insight, motivation, a book, a class, a free ticket. Notice everything that had to happen to get you here so it finally makes sense and it was worth it. It was worth the challenges, the feelings, the emotions coming and going because you already had this the whole time. Good. Now float into your future 6 months in front of that and land into that. Now that you're there, notice it's no big deal. This is how your life was last month. You can now rest into it. This is how it was the month before that and before that and before that and before that. It's no big deal now. Now think about your future now because of the past 6 months. It makes sense what's coming your way now because this is easy for you. This is what you now have grown into. This is what you've learned. And everything that needed to happen got you here. And now feel the gratitude in your heart. Soak it in. And one more time, soak it into every cell in your being. And now feel yourself floating up out of your timeline again, looking down. Go to that 6 month mark before, so the first time it happened. So go back 6 months to the first time it happened. And now go above your timeline. And now feel how grateful you are as you come all the way back to now. And now drop into your body and notice what needs to be accepted, released, and allowed for your body to get excited. Now notice the first goal that's achievable, that's within reach, that's the beginning of getting there, and see that all your energies, unconscious energies, not you, you're too busy intending and getting out of the way and loving the moment. Notice that your body's wanting to get you closer to that first goal. So doing whatever it takes because it's achievable and it knows where it's headed. Because once that happens, then that's happening, and that's happening, and that's happening, and that's happening. And you're giving yourself the right to have it now internally, so you're now wanting it externally. You're craving it externally, but you're loving it internally. And now open your eyes, and now notice you don't have that now, but notice that you want to take the first step to getting closer to it. So now this goal is in your future rather than just a future. I hope this was helpful. You guys have been really, really kind and great and engaged the whole time. And if you're interested in more of this, we start in, I think, 2 weeks, September, the first weekend of September. It's 10 days, 1 weekend a month, each month. So you have a whole month to integrate all this stuff. This is just the tip of the iceberg. It's a life-changing program. So is Hypnosis Motivation Institute, the hypnosis training. So if you're interested in that, join us. If you're interested in complimentary hypnosis sessions, talk to them out the front, fill out your form, and you'll get hypnosis sessions with our interns. And I think they're unlimited. So you'll be able to get this kind of stuff all day. Once a week, every day in your recordings, and just live like this. But here's the thing, you have to commit. I'm gonna leave you with this one thing. You know the most profound realization I had that made with the weight loss especially? As soon as your brain says later in stopping something, I'll stop eating that ice cream, whatever, or later in starting something, I'm gonna go to the gym. As soon as your brain says that no and say to yourself, I will never, ever, ever have that goal. Because I will never feel the same, I will never feel any different than now in taking that action. So tomorrow is not gonna feel any different. So if I'm not doing it now, it's a trick played on your brain to never make it happen. So then when you put it in your awareness and you go, oh, I will never have this goal unless I take the action right now or stop taking the action right now, it will never happen. And when you do that, then all of a sudden, you're like, there's no choice. I have to do a push-up. I have to not eat that ice cream. Because if I do, it will never happen. That goal will never happen. If you do that, you start tricking the brain and tricking and trying to trick you. You beat the brain at its own game. So it goes, holy cow. But if you give it a reward, it goes, all right. But if you're doing it because you have to, you should, everyone says you should, forget it. The brain will hijack you. But if you give it, it's okay, we're going to get there. Really? Yeah, we're getting closer. Yeah, all right, okay. I can take this action and burn some energy. All right. I cannot take that action anymore and burn some energy. All right. And so when you make these commitments to yourself, make sure you're doing whatever it takes to do it now. If you're thinking, oh, I should do some hypnosis sessions with the interns, and you say I should, it's never going to happen. So know that. It's not going to happen. If you want to join the school, for example, and then it's not going to happen. If you want to go home and start practicing this every day, and you go, I'm going to start doing it tomorrow or meditate, it's not going to happen. So say that to yourself, and you watch how you control that brain. All right? Thank you, guys. Have a great night. I really appreciate it. Thank you.